not me, not me.
It's our other guy, Chad.
And the thing about it, you know, you have him. Absolutely.
Hey, guys.
Good morning.
It's funny, I thought I was making a drive.
How are you?
Good, how are you?
See if you can go back to me.
All you see is.
He did that. Oh, sorry.
May we enter?
Not yet.
Okay, thank you.
I started thinking, I said, I wonder if the guy that owns him thinks he knows he's got him. You know? And then if he wanted him, where would he?
How are you gonna get him?
Where would he start going to get him?
We were out in Utah years ago, and we're in the middle of nowhere in Utah. We pull up to a DOT, there's a person out there with a stop, and they're doing some grading or something on the road. So we're sitting there, and also their walkie-talkie goes off. And they're talking this conversation about lunch. Somebody says, I want Subway. That's a good idea, Subway. I'll try and say, where's Subway? She goes, Green River. So that's 2 hours away from here. She looks at me, she goes, yeah.
And you pointed.
Yeah, that's where you go for Subway. You drive there and get it, bring it back out here to the crew.
You think about, we don't think anything about if we need, you know, run to the grocery store. We just get a car and run up the store. Well, not out there.
It's a plan ahead.
You know,
you got a plan for it.
You plan and you get everything you need, and that whatever weekly trip or bi-weekly trip,
And they drive fast out there.
You know,
got those long straight roads, and they
back several years ago, it was one of those states, either Wyoming or Montana. They absolutely get away with the maximum speed on the interstate, and then they got into a disagreement with the federal highway people about, you know, grant money and this and that. They, you know, but there was a period of time that they actually completely did away with the maximum speed. It was just like, let her rip.
That's right. That's exactly. I remember we had a.
Hey,
how you doing,
Ashley?
Good to see you.
If you go up from Westgate all the way up.
Good.
How are you
this morning?
Yeah. Two-lane road.
Yeah.
Good morning. Y'all ready?
Good morning.
Did you fam come down the aisle?
Yeah, it's rolling.
He's doing better. He's got a big boot that got him in.
Right.
And all this was over.
How you doing?
Yeah.
Hey,
got you and then it just set up.
Morning. How are you doing?
Real
good to see you.
Same thing, Charlie.
Definitely.
Yeah,
he never had any kind of a wound.
Yeah,
it's
really painful.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I
reading in the synopsis.
Excuse me, it's not me.
Did you get my email saying when and where it was?
For this?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. I thought I'd sent you.
You did.
Doug said he'll be here just a moment. He apologizes for running out. Thank you.
Exactly. So you just never know.
Hey, Chuck, how are you? They sent me something. Did you send it?
More problems?
No, we do email. I don't do text.
Y'all do the email on here?
We don't do text.
Write a letter, Mel.
Usually wait till you see them, they send me stuff.
Need carrier pigeons, you know. Courthouse over to jail.
Of course. You have a gun, I have a gun.
Sorry for the delay. We'll go ahead and get started. The Kathy, we have a quorum. Go ahead and call the meeting to order. And the first item of business is the adoption of the agenda. You have in front of you any changes to the agenda. Hearing none, is there a motion to adopt the agenda as presented?
So moved.
Second.
Second, I have a motion and a second. Those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed signify by the same sign. Being none, that passes unanimously. The next item is the adoption of the minutes from the meeting of the April 25th, 2012 meeting. You have those in front of you as well. Is there a motion to adopt those minutes?
So moved, Mr. Chair.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, there being none, that passes unanimously. The next item on the agenda is discussion of House Bill 397. And that is, as you know, that's the Georgia Open Meetings, Open Records Law. And we wanted to discuss its impact on the previously created subcommittees. Those are the committees that this group assembled for the purpose of reviewing and being a selection committee and reviewing the RFPs for the program manager. And then the following meeting, we agreed to assemble another committee made up of the same members for review of RFPs for architectural services. I've asked Ken Jarrard to be here today to go over how House Bill 397 impacts what we did, as it is a subcommittee of a committee, so it then becomes subject to open meetings. So I've got Ken here today to walk us through that.
Welcome, thank you for allowing me to speak. I won't take a long time, but I will try and get into the nuts and bolts of the new law. The new Open Meetings Act is a significant departure from the last law, and quite frankly, or the old law, quite frankly, one of the biggest moving part of the new law that is, I think it needs to be vetted in this room, deals with the treatment of committees. The old law stated that a committee that was created that contained members of the governing authority was subject to the act, all right? So if the Board of Commissioners created a committee and it was comprised of two members or a member of the Board of Commissioners, we all knew that was subject to the Open Meetings Act. The new law does something different than that. The new law says that an agency that creates a committee, which of course you are a committee that is subject to the Open Meetings Act, if you create a subcommittee, you are subject, or that subcommittee is subject to the Open Meetings Act. It says, the Open Meetings Act now says, the gathering of a quorum of any committee of the members of the governing body or a quorum of any committee created by the governing body. So you are a committee created by the governing body and you are, of course, subject to the Act. If you create a subcommittee, you could be subject to the Act as well. Because this is, of course, you're a committee governed by the Act creating a subcommittee. So you need to be mindful about that. When we gave this discussion at some of the seminars I've participated in, a lot of folks have said, well, the only answer is to not create as many committees or subcommittees subject to the Act. And I just want you to be mindful about that as well. The problem you've got with respect to your subcommittees or your committee is that you're going to be reviewing documents that are subject to being withheld under the Open Records Act, right? Because you're going to be looking at RFP information, and that's something I want you all to think about as well, because what the Open Records Act now provides is that documents that can be withheld under the Open Records Act can be talked about in executive session, all right? So that's another piece of information that I want you to be mindful of. Can be talked about in executive session. Whether you all want to handle it that way is up to you, of course. You may simply choose to disband your subcommittee and try to handle this by way of an informal process, which is what a lot of other folks are doing. But I just want to caution you that once you start making and branching out into subcommittees, it does raise a question that those subcommittees can be subject to the Open Meetings Act, and that can present some procedural hurdles as well. Okay? So do you have any questions of me? What's the subcommittee that's been created?
It's the selection committee, and they are tasked with reviewing our proposals for, as Doug said, the program manager, project manager, and for our architects. Since this board voted on that subcommittee now, and with this new law in place, that would mean it would be a public meeting, and we'd have to give notice that it was a public meeting. But there comes the muddy part of it. The documents we're reviewing are not open to the public. They are closed documents. And for us to really have value and to be able to discuss them in a committee, to negotiate, to discuss, to look at their qualifications and look at their items, it would have to be closed because, like I said, the documents are closed, and you can't have the competitors sitting there hearing what the other people have proposed. So it adds a layer to the committee in that we, from what I'm hearing Ken Jarrard saying, we'd have to announce the meeting, then we'd have to go into executive session, and then we'd have to come out of executive session and close the meeting. Or we have a more informal committee. Usually the selection committees are just chosen by my department. It's not a set committee. So I don't know if there's a perfect answer, but this is what we've been dealt with the law, and it needs to be cleared up or
I appreciate that. Let me walk you through it, because it may help if I walk you through it. What it says is that the Open Meetings Act now says that it applies to every department, agency, board, bureau, office, commission, authority, or similar body of each such county. All right, so if you have become an agency under the Act, which I believe you have, then the law says that the gathering of a quorum of any committee of the members of the governing body or of a quorum of any committee created by the governing body, I think is you, that's subject to the Act as well. So I feel like, you know, if it was a close call, I feel like it's probably 75-25 that you're there. How then do you review records that are subject to being withheld until such time as the RFP is awarded? You know, Don and I were talking about this earlier. There's a legitimate public policy reason why those records get to be withheld until after there is a award. If I have submitted as a company and submitted RFP documents and the subcommittee is going to look through them and discuss them, and is sitting there looking at an RFP, by the way, is, as you all understand, it's much more fluid than a bid. RFP is based upon trying to meet an objective of the county, and it's a little more fluid, and sometimes there can be, you know, reaching out and trying to massage a certain element, and they come back and say, well, how about we do it this way? If I'm sitting there with my competitor right next to me while this subcommittee is going through the nuts and bolts of the RFP, well, they may tailor how they respond based upon exactly what they're hearing is important to you. or they may respond based upon what their competitor has put in theirs, and so the county may not get the benefit of true competition, because they're simply just going to take it. So you see, there's a reason why this is not supposed to be, because quite frankly, the interest of the county or any local government could be negatively impacted if these documents get to come out. So that's the reason for the rule. Question is how do you deal with them? What the Open Records Act says is you can go into executive session and talk about documents that are protected by the Open Records Act so long as there is no other reasonable basis to review those records. All right, well, what does that mean? No other reasonable basis to review the records? Well, I'm not sure what it means, but I will say this. The context I typically think of that is would be like in a courthouse security plan. Courthouse security plan is a plan that is protected under the Act, under the Open Records Act, and the Board of Commissioners or whomever, whatever agency, has every right to go into executive session and review that plan, the very documents of which the disclosure would compromise the very thing it's attempting to achieve. All right? That's sort of the same situation we're in now. But Don is correct that once you start talking about going into an executive session of a subcommittee, that just gets a little bit procedurally a little bit difficult. You do have to take minutes in executive session now, et cetera, et cetera. So I just caution you about that. So as I see it, you have a couple of options. One, you could absolve the subcommittee altogether if you wanted to. Number two, maintain the subcommittee, go into executive session to discuss the RFPs. Do that. Or you could just keep the subcommittee and just discuss it out in the open. We certainly have the right to waive that RFP rule. And could certainly let these documents be out in the open. My fear there, though, folks, is that I do think we might imperil, quite frankly, the utility of the RFP process if we do it that way.
On your first option, Ken, though, how would you discuss this if you absolve the subcommittee? How are you going to discuss it?
You would just have to discuss it informally, not as the assembled agency.
But isn't that putting form over substance, though?
The Open Meetings Act is very clear that the committee has to be created by the agency, created by the governing body. If you've created it, it's going to have to be subject to the Open Meetings Act. You can't meet, in groups of a quorum or greater without complying with the Act.
I've been reading about some recent events where the Attorney General's office has said that, well, you can't do something just to try to get around it, though. Like, you can't, two members can't meet just to try to get around the...
That's right. That's right. But, it would depend on the size of the committee you're talking about. For instance, we had the same issue with, I'll just go ahead and say it because it's the one that comes to mind, was with the water negotiations. And, of course, two members of the board, the board attempted to create a committee of two members, and they didn't like the outcome because of the procedure that would have governed them. But if those same identical two members had met and discussed that same issue, there wouldn't have been a problem with the Act. And I confirm that with the Attorney General. So you see what I'm saying? It was the creation of the committee that caused the procedural problem. If that's unsatisfactory, and to the judge's point, if you're concerned about elevating form over substance, then the way to do it would be to keep the committee, but then follow the procedures to go into executive session, state on the record that there's no other reasonable way to review these documents without doing that, and then handle it following the exact letter of the law.
Let me clarify, Ken. We would be faced with the same dilemma regardless of whether it is a subcommittee or this committee.
Correct.
To preserve the integrity of the RFPs and the competitive process, it doesn't matter which one of them reviews it, we're still going to be faced with the same dilemma.
Good. That's a good question.
And
yes.
My recollection, if I'm incorrect, was the reason for the creation of the subcommittee was to have that subcommittee do the raw work as these RFPs came in to review, give them some type of a grade, and then bring their results to the full committee for us then to review what they discovered. So. But once again, I have no problem. I agree with you. The meeting should be in compliance and publicly open. But we're going to be faced with the same dilemma regardless of which, if it's this one or the subcommittee that reviews those documents.
And I think that was the judge's, yes, I think that was the judge's.
Since we've already formed the committee, is what, would it make sense just to have them go in executive session? I mean, just follow that letter to law?
Might, that might be the best way to do it. Or it might be the best for the entirety of the committee. I mean, that's up to you, but to the sheriff's point, it seems to me like you're probably in the same boat, irrespective of which, whether you, even if the full committee wanted to consider it, you're still gonna have to either consider them out in the open, in which case you jeopardize the RFP process, because obviously you may not get as good of a benefit, or you go ahead and do an executive session and just stay close, make sure that you stay close and follow the rules of executive session precisely.
Donna, any other challenges with entering into executive session for discussion of RFPs?
Well, it would be a new day for us, right, to have to handle it that way. That's not our normal way of having to operate. So again, it would just procedurally be a little bit more difficult, and not in anything except that we have to post the notices. I'd have to have someone there that could take minutes for us in executive session. The only thing that we do discuss is the documents, so it would be very brief. So that's all. It just adds another layer of making sure that we're doing it correctly. And as Ken said, when the committee was formed, this House bill wasn't in place, so we didn't realize how the effect it would have on us. And so we just want to make it clear that it does add another, I don't want to use the word burden, but another task for us to make sure it's done in accordance with.
And that's a good point, because the first committee that this committee formed was prior to the House bill going into effect. So it's not the fault of this committee. We were doing what we thought was the appropriate thing to do at the time, and it may still be the appropriate thing to do, but we wanted to lay out the changes and give you some time to think about, talk about the options.
And to be fair, this notion of this impacting the RFP process may have been an unintended consequence, quite frankly, of this new rewrite, and it may be something that you know, we need to bring to the Attorney General's attention, just to let him understand that with respect to particular committees dealing with RFPs, it's procedurally awkward a little bit. So.
Donna, you during the process, you also interview
Exactly. We would hope that we would have a short list, then we would do the interviews. Now, Ken, are you saying that the interviews would be open, or could they be closed?
I got to tell you, to the extent that we're looking at that in the Open Meetings Act, I'm not aware of an exemption that would allow that. You know, the Open Meetings Act just got changed to allow the interviewing of an executive head of an agency in executive session, and I think that the Attorney General thought that was a very, significant concession to local government. So I extrapolate from that the notion of other folks coming into executive session is going to be construed narrowly. Right now, I've got a section in the code that says that portions of a meeting during which a portion of a record that is made exempt from public inspection, RFPs, RFP documents, may be discussed in executive session so long as there are no reasonable means by which the agency can consider the record without disclosing the exempt portions. That's the only exemption I have that applies to you all. So that's the only thing I'm going to allow to go into executive. We'll be to discuss that.
So the interviews would have to be in the open?
If they are, and again, I know this sounds like I'm being redundant, but if they are to occur in front of the committee or with a subcommittee created by that committee, yes. The reason this didn't arise in the past is because the law didn't address this. Committees that didn't contain board members didn't have to comply with the Open Meetings Act. It was easy. Now it does. And also, sometimes there was no committee formed at all, right? It was just simply a loose amalgamation of staff that would review these things.
It was a selection committee that we just, of the users of the departments that were affected. and that, on the interviews, and that poses a challenge, because a lot of times the interviews are pretty straightforward. It's your qualifications, you know, what did you present? But then there are times that we will, what if we go out down into the actual negotiation of our scope and pricing? That adds another layer.
So, I'm sorry if I'm the, you know, the bearer of bad news. I don't think it's bad news. I just think it's the procedural world that we live in now. And I just want to make sure we get it right. And I know that you will.
And truly, when Ken provided the whole county departments an overview of the open records and open meetings, my first thought came to this committee and another committee that was formed. And I said, I think we need to discuss this and make sure we do it right. So.
Well, you wouldn't be entering into negotiations in the interview. You would be simply just interviewing the contractor or the architect or engineer, asking them questions, taking your notes, and then you could excuse them and go into executive session and discuss that.
That's right. You know, the key is going to be, that's a great point. I see exactly where you're going. The key is going to be, is Donna's going to have to read that exemption under the Open Records Act carefully about what is allowed to be an exempt document, and she knows it well. And you just need to tailor your executive session to discussing those portions of those documents to your that, which is exactly the point you were making.
And you're correct. And the only thing I just want to say, and I want everyone to hear, is when we do the interviews, that means the competitors can be in the same room at the same time, and so our questions would have to be very specific and the same for everyone to make it fair and equitable to everyone, because otherwise everyone's hearing what they're saying.
Right.
That's I know everyone's going to want to be last.
Yeah.
I'm not going to want anyone to be first.
That's right. I'll say it's probably going to be less give and take in an interview with a potential contractor, engineer, or architect than there would be if it wasn't open to the public. So it is what it is. You have to ask the questions that you have to ask. Then you can go into executive session and say, and discuss the pros and cons of various ones who are bidding on the project.
Just want everyone to be aware of that.
Additional questions or discussion?
I will tell you that I have been asked to reach out to the Attorney General's office just to confirm everything that I'm telling you. I think that is, in this context, appropriate. I will. And I will report back if there's anything different than what I'm telling you from their perspective.
Donna, provide us, if you will, the dates for program manager.
The program manager, it closes tomorrow.
Close.
We actually have a first committee meeting, you know, tentatively scheduled for the 30th, selection committee, following next week. So we'll plan accordingly. And that first meeting is usually when we set the next meetings, and that can always just be discussed.
But if in fact you assemble that committee on the 30th, we've actually got to notify them.
Yes.
Put the notes out today,
yes.
7 days in advance of the meeting.
Right. That's why this timing was very important, so I knew what to do. And the committee realized that might have to change. The date might have to change based on what was discussed. So.
Ken, when do you think you'll have an answer back from the Attorney General
this week? I'll try. I mean, it'll be informal. I'll talk to them.
I would suggest that the committee has, we certainly have a commitment to be in compliance with all parts of the Act. I think I go back to what I said earlier. All the things we're talking about here that require compliance are going to be in place, whether it is the subcommittee that's doing the work or if it's this committee that's doing it. Am I not correct? It's going, it's the same issues are going to have to be complied with regardless of which body is involved.
Well, and Sheriff, you've given me the opening to say this. That's one of the focuses that I'm going to have when I call downtown, is to ensure that my interpretation that that you are a governing body of an agency is true, is accurate. If they agree with that, then everything you just said is correct. But if they tell me, no, that's too much, that you're not a governing body of an agency, then I will come back and I will tell you that my opinion has changed and that the subcommittees can meet informally without following the act. That's going to be the key issue that we'll discuss.
But the real question today is, do we keep the subcommittee in place and follow the open meetings laws and so forth, or do we just disband the subcommittee and then just tell the purchasing office, like you've done, like I guess you've done in the past, take a look at those RFPs, purchasing department, and then come back to the committee with them. But my concern is form over substance. Since we've already created this subcommittee, and we're going, if we disband it today, and then they still need to do the same thing, can't the argument be made that we're just trying to do this to get around the requirements?
If the scenario you just rolled out, Your Honor, was that Donna, armed with the exact same people, do the exact same thing.
Right.
Yeah, that's not terribly strong.
I think a good argument can be made that you're just trying to get around the requirements, And now, I guess if it was just the people in purchasing looking at them, it'd be different. But I want my court administrator to be looking at them, because she's the one who's going to be knowledgeable about what she's looking for in an architect, engineer, or a program manager, because she's the court administrator. So I want her looking at them. So really the same people are going to have to be looking at them, and I fear that a good argument can be made before a court that now you're just trying to get around it.
I would echo it in as much that, with personal department, I have full confidence. Obviously, when we're dealing with issues of a bid that's put out for a particular product, as long as the specifications are made, yes, the personal department is very competent and able to go through those bids and establish which one is the lowest qualified bidder. But once again, we're talking about an RFP here, and with a submission that only being reviewed by purchasing, I believe the issue you're once again going to have is having to pick up the phone and constantly call other members of the committee or subcommittee to establish whether or not this is, we're in the right ballpark here. I think that, once again, that's going to add confusion and issues relative to the scope of the work here, because of what is being constructed. Both facilities have a tremendous amount of specialization that's got to go into them that goes way beyond the scope of establishing who's a low bidder.
Right. And I totally agree. And that's why the pricing is separate. It's not even looked at in the beginning. We're looking at their proposals to provide us quality, best practices, their knowledge. That's what we're looking for. We're not looking, we want best value, we need best absolute, so we can have a truly successful project. And to do that, we have to have the right people. It's not a dollar amount. So, and that's why we have selection committees, Sheriff, for that very reason. And it's not just the procurement office, because we do need end users. We need to have their input. Everyone wears a different hat at that selection committee, and every hat is important.
What my action items will be is that I will reach out and call downtown, as I mentioned. I'll report back to Donna and Doug if there's any change to my opinion. If not, and of course it's up to the committee what action you all choose to take in light of this information, but if you proceed to go forward, this will be a first plunge into the water, and it'll be a good test ground to try this. And we'll do the best we can, and I'll help you as much as I can to get it right.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we go ahead with advertising for the subcommittee's meeting, complying with the open records laws, and treating the subcommittee as if it is subject to the open records laws, and going that route at this time.
Form of motion.
That's form of motion.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Any discussion? We vote on the motion. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All those opposed, like sign. Being none, passes unanimously. Any other business to come before this board? Being none, is there a motion to adjourn?
Move.
Second?
Second.
Adjourn. Thank you very much.
Finding fingers.
How you been?